Welcome back to Wood for the Trees, a series dedicated to exploring the future of our woodlands. Today, I'm at the stunning Stourhead Western Estate to meet David Pengelly, a leading advocate and practitioner of continuous cover forestry. Now, continuous cover forestry appears to be the forestry equivalent of having your cake and eating it. In a nutshell, the claim is that properly managed, a woodland can be diverse, it can be resilient, and it can be profitable through the sales of high quality timber. And if that's not enough, the claim is that cost and disruption can be kept to a minimum by replacing felled trees through natural regeneration. Now, this sounds promising, but is it too good to be true? I spent much of last year working on the National Wood Strategy, which emphasised the need to increase the production of timber in this country, but also the need to increase diversity and resilience in our woodlands in the face of climate change and the many emerging threats and diseases. I'm eager to find out how continuous cover forestry is different to other forestry approaches, how such an approach can increase the economic potential while also enhancing the ecological condition of the woodlands. So let's go and find David. Good morning, David.
Hello, Tom. Nice to meet you. And welcome to Stourhead Western Estate.
Well, thank you very much for having us. Okay, we're here today to find out about this method called continuous cover forestry. So, David, I'm going to challenge you to explain to non-foresters such as myself and many of our viewers what continuous cover forestry is.
The easiest thing to do is say what it isn't. And it is not clear felling and replanting. It's maintaining your forest as an ecosystem. It's allowing species to adapt to the site. It's promoting the development of vertical structures. There couldn't be a better example than what we're standing in. It's a really good place to illustrate it. You can see we've got massive trees in here. We've got small trees, we've got natural regeneration, and that's one of the aims, is to have a distribution of all tree sizes through the system. And the aim is that we never have to clear fell. And ultimately, in terms of harvesting, you're looking to actually create an environment where you can actually harvest the increment and maintain your forest ecosystem as a whole.
And these young saplings, have you planted them?
No, all the saplings, seedlings, and regeneration you see here is all natural, apart from the group of broadleaf behind, which is actually a planted group of sweet chestnut tree. And you can see the benign conditions which have created this environment does enable retention of deadwood and broadleaf features in these conifer dominated stands, which contribute a lot to biodiversity and the functioning ecosystem as a whole.
So how does continuous cover forestry differ from other approaches to forestry management?
Irregular forestry, which is how I term the system of continuous cover we're applying here, is fundamentally different from even aged forestry. Even aged thinnings, you would be doing low thinning. You're taking out small trees, trying to make the whole crop uniform. Whereas we're looking to irregularize our crop completely.
So with even age, all the trees are coming up together. And so by definition, they all end up at the same age.
Yeah. Okay. And in an irregular system, you're relying on diffuse light, because you've got lower growing stocking of trees. Mm-hmm. The diffuse light creates a fine branching in your regeneration and your poles. Because we have lower growing stocks in this irregular system compared with a clear cut system, the crowns on the trees are deeper and they keep growing into the very large size classes, which they don't do in even age systems. And then periodically, after we do the harvesting intervention, will come through, the tending gang will come through, and they'll do respacing in here, promoting the target species. And then on a cycle of say 5 years, you're coming in to do what I call a selection felling, which is actually a thinning and a harvesting removal of some of the trees. Just imagine if you could harvest 5 or 6 of those every 5 years, and that produces you 80 cubic meters of timber.
But at the same time, you've still got everything else left behind.
Precisely.
For the next next rotation.
And everything
next
is growing.
Generation.
The forest is so dynamic, everything's growing so fast, especially as they've got these deeper crowns.
So how does using CCF, or irregular forestry as you described it, help the owners achieve their objectives?
We could aim to achieve the objectives of management by pursuing a clearfell replant system. But in my view, that is not sustainable in the long term because it just does not build up enough resilience in your forest. If you think about where we're going with climate change, and it's quite shocking, increased storm, increased drought, just increase in major events, the biotic factors that come with it, the pest and disease. Because at the moment we're getting incredible amounts of rain, yet a lot of our species here, our trees, are still showing symptoms of drought. And that's because we're getting drought as well. Snow, we're getting more wet snow now instead of proper snow. We had catastrophic damage in some of our even age elements here in 2003 when we just did a thinning and then we had some wet snow in April. Everything bent over, but in the existing forest it was protected. Same with the windblow. When we get storms, we get hardly any damage through a whole stand. We get sporadic pockets and damage, but they can be replenished through natural regeneration and planting. In contrast to an irregular forest, it can absorb these shocks. But if you're getting a bit of sporadic damage in your even-aged stand, at what point do you decide, I need to go in and clear that up and replant it, or do I just leave it until my rest of my stand is mature and clear fell it and clear it up then? So you've got a loss of productivity in that system. Whereas again, in the irregular forest, you've got complete flexibility and adaption. The other great benefit of irregular forestry, when you have your right species of the right quality in your stands, is to promote and use natural regeneration as a way of restocking your forest as much as possible. And that's very important with ash. When you think about ash dieback, because we know that the vulnerability of ash trees to ash dieback disease is a combination of genes. Allowing trees to naturally regenerate and respond to the environment they're in is critical, and it's something you don't get necessarily with trees which are coming from a nursery.
When we were actually off camera earlier, you said something really interesting as well about the larch and the larch disease, and how having larch spread throughout the stands of trees rather than in effectively monocultures helps to dilute the disease effectively and helps to then protect the remaining larch trees.
The larch disease, Phytophthora ramorum, is driven where you've got monocultures of larch, and so the inoculum level gets so high it just spreads through the whole stand rapidly and will start impacting on other tree species as well, as we know. We've actually got a residue of a bit of larch natural regen through the estate, which at the moment is not showing any signs of the disease, and we're hoping by having a lower population mixed in with other species that sort of threshold where it all has to get wiped out because of the disease is avoided. And we feel it's possibly the same with a lot of the diseases. I think it's having different species in your stand allows a bit of adaption and provides mitigation going forward. In a regular forest, the impacts are softened and not catastrophic.
What's really interesting actually is that often we talk about climate change as something that's going to happen in the future. Mm-hmm. But what you're really saying is that climate change is already happening. Mm. It's happening in this woodland here. Mm-hmm. Obviously, we know that the diseases are already happening with the larch, with the ash dieback. Mm-hmm. And that this approach to forestry here is allowing you to maintain, as you say, a more resilient woodland, a more diverse woodland that will be able to protect itself more to these threats as they accelerate into the future.
Yes, that's right.
Can you also tell us a bit about the ecological benefits of managing a woodland in this way?
Yeah, certainly, because it's one that's been on our mind for a while. What is a forest of this nature, of this composition and this structure? What is it delivering in terms of biodiversity? And Henry and Nick Hall got behind a biodiversity research project, which we did over 3 years. What we looked at is to see if there's any relationship between the amount of broadleaf in your conifer-dominated stands the level of growing stock, so how densely stocked your stands are. The deadwood, there was quite surprised to find marsh tit in here and also spotted flycatcher, which are both on the red list. In terms of bats, there were 13 bats here, which is like 76% of bat species here. And what's quite interesting is with this is thinking about where is this in relation to, say, an optimum site like a SSSI broadly woodland. And interestingly, there was a research project done at Rushmore Estate about 10 years ago, looking at this in a similar light. And the amount of biodiversity in here, for example, with the moths, is something like 60% of what they're finding in the broadleaf stands at Rushmore. And bats, again, the bat level here is up there, possibly slightly higher even. I think that's because of the lesser and greater horseshoe bat. So it's evidently delivering a huge amount of biodiversity.
I mean, that's really interesting, isn't it? Because there is this perception out there that conifer woodlands, and I think people visualise conifer woodlands as those even age, very dense, very dark places being completely devoid of biodiversity. And where we are now and what we're stood amongst is, as you say, 75% conifer. It is productive in that you're extracting timber, but you've also got these very, very good levels of biodiversity.
Yeah, so there are some key features which are actually driving and providing habitats. It's deadwood, it is the forest structure, so the fact we have lower growing stocks, more light rotated around the forest. It's also the complexity of habitat that's provided in the system, which actually is providing more niches for different species.
And by deadwood, you're talking about trees like that behind us?
Yeah, that's right. Standing deadwood being even more valuable than deadwood on the ground.
So really what we're saying is that the diversity in all its forms is encouraging higher levels of biodiversity.
I think it demonstrates the value of a functioning ecosystem, which you don't get if you manage your stands by some of the other systems. The other species which has increased massively in the last 25 years, and it's not necessary just because it's an irregular forest, and that is goshawk. We now are aware of 5 or 6 different nesting pairs on the 650 hectare estate. But what we do know from research the Forestry Commission have done is that one of their highest prey on their list is grey squirrels. So they're serving a great function, as well as our guys that are controlling the grey squirrels as well. So.
Yeah. And talking about grey squirrels, I believe that you are doing something with the pine marten on this estate.
Yes, we have been exploring reintroducing pine marten because we are aware that they do have a deterrent factor with grey squirrels, both with predating and creating a fear factor where they move out of their territory. So that would be lovely to have one day.